Mexico's economy is almost always forgotten when we look at North America. This may be partially justified since Mexico makes up only about 5% of North America's GDP. However, with a GDP of 1.2 trillion, it cannot be ignored as an up-and-coming secondary power and a decisive factor in Latin America. Welcome to Economics Matters, and in today's video, we look at the complicated economy of Mexico. To say that the Mexican economy is dependent on the US is an understatement. 80% of Mexico's exports end up in the US. And the US is also a source of inward remittances for Mexico. As you all probably know, inward remittances is money transferred by an immigrant to his home country. And since millions of Mexicans work in Mexico, often young males looking to better their situation for not only themselves but also their families, billions of dollars are sent back to Mexico every year. Now, how was Mexico doing before COVID? Safe to say, not very well. In 2019, the Mexican economy shrank by 0.1% compared to a growth of 2.1% in 2018. And with a GDP per capita of $10,118, classifying it as a developing/emerging economy, this puts it firmly behind others in its group, where the average growth rate was 4.1%, some even achieving double digits in 2019. Mexico is also on the higher side, or in this case, the lower side, in terms of inequality, with a Gini coefficient of 0.498 out of 1. For those who are new to economics, the Gini coefficient measures the inequality of a country, with 0 being the lowest and 1 being the highest. Usually, a Gini coefficient of 0.35 is considered good. Now, Mexico has consistently kept a low debt-to-GDP ratio, averaging around 50%, unlike its neighbor to the north. This may have been a very wise decision since it allows them to expend more firepower than, say, Argentina, who has a debt-to-GDP ratio of 96% as of 2020. However, as we shall see in this video, this has not been the case. Mexico's economy has suffered tremendously under the pressure of COVID, with analysts expecting a decline of 10.5% in 2020, and unlike other developing countries like India, which may take a less, although still significant hit due to COVID and recover quickly, analysts predict that Mexico's recovery will be slow and gradual. This may not come as a shocker, since the Mexican government's budget for 2020 had only about a negative 2.6% deficit. Compare this to its neighbor, the US, which has a budget deficit of negative 50%, and we start to get a clearer picture of why the Mexican economy has suffered so badly. Now, before we understand why the Mexican economy has done so badly in 2020, we need to know why the Mexican economy did so poorly in 2019 and before. The first year of the then newly elected president, López Obrador, was particularly shaky. This led to a sense of uncertainty, and one of the key factors of economic growth is stability. So unsurprisingly, this had an effect on the Mexican economy. This has also been the case in 2020, with his approval rating, which used to be above 60%, going below 50% for the first time. Polls cite the major reasons being due to public security concerns, a struggling economy, and the COVID crisis. Secondly, and equally important, was reduced domestic demand and a decrease in both public and foreign investment in 2019. Now that we know the reasons why Mexico's economy was ailing, we come to why it has done so badly in 2020. Mexico's economy is reliant on oil exports. Almost one-third of government revenue comes from oil, and with oil hitting record lows in April and May, this means that one of the pipelines, pun not intended, for a stimulus package and a speedy recovery was cut off. However, all is not so gloomy in the land of economic statistics for Mexico. As I said before, It has a lower debt to GDP ratio. Household debt, or in other words, the people's debt, is at 16% of GDP. This means that with the right government policies, public consumption could go up without adding much strain to people's finances. Inflation was above the target, but not by much, and it did slow down to 3.6% in 2019. This was much lower than the average inflation rate of 4.78% for developing economies similar to Mexico's stature. And due to COVID and low oil prices, this is expected to drop to 2.8% for 2020. And contrary to popular belief, inflation is expected to decrease for most countries such as the US, UK and other economies. This has mainly to do with how governments raise capital to fund stimulus packages and varies from country to country. We shall discuss this in another episode of Economics Matters. So subscribe and inflate Economics Matters subscription number. So where were we? Yes, low inflation, household debt and debt to GDP. But not only this, Mexico's unemployment rate has remained relatively stable during COVID, only increasing from 3.3% to 5.3% in 2020. Now, we shall go deeper into the Mexican economy, looking at the various sectors. The Mexican economy has a problem of overemployment in the agricultural sector. And as an Indian, I know too much about this problem. In India, we call it disguised labor. This is a situation where the people employed, usually in the agricultural sector, do not really contribute to productivity. Usually, to get a surface level understanding that this is occurring in an economy, I like to look at the agricultural sector's contribution to GDP, which in Mexico's case is 3.4%, and the percent of the workforce that works in the agricultural sector, which in Mexico's case is 13%. This clearly shows that there is some degree of quote-unquote disguised labor in Mexico's agricultural sector. Mexico has a large manufacturing sector and is the leading exporter of many important resources like silver, zinc, and mercury. Also, it has a largely untapped oil reserve and a booming oil industry. Many American companies have moved their industry to Mexico due to NAFTA, providing a boost to the manufacturing sector of the developing economy. Mexico has emerged as a major aerospace manufacturer, with many American aerospace companies like Boeing, Bombardier, Goodrich, etc. setting up factories in Mexico. The construction sector is another diverse and dynamic industry within Mexico. Overall, the Mexican manufacturing sector represents 30.9% of Mexico's GDP and employs 26% of its workforce. Since Mexico is a developing country, it benefits from relatively low living costs. These low living costs are hidden behind the dollar. What I mean by this is that GDP uses dollars to provide a homogeneous metric. This means that in reality, Mexico's GDP in terms of purchasing power is $2.4 trillion, not $1.2 trillion. This means that due to its proximity to the largest economy in the world, its beautiful beaches and topography, and its relatively low living costs, Mexico has become a tourist destination for Americans. Although the high crime rate and the presence of cartels and gangs does hinder that to an extent. Now, there are many problems that Mexico has to tackle. Its economic dependence on the US, poor infrastructure, and an underfunded education sector, a large informal sector that accounts for 60% of Mexico's employment, its sky-high crime rate, and an underfunded oil sector. But it does show signs of hope, meaning that with the right government policies to tackle these issues, Mexico could emerge as the third developed economy in the Americas. To say that the Mexican economy is dependent on the US is an understatement. 80% of Mexico's exports end up in the US. That's it for this episode of Economics Matters. Support Economics Matters by inflating our subscription number. In other words, subscribe.